Good morning and welcome to worship. It is so wonderful to see your faces, and a special welcome to those of you who are worshiping online with us. I would like you to find your black friendship pads in the pew and write your names down in those. That helps us know who is here, and it also allows you the opportunity to RSVP for our Wednesday night dinner if you would like. This week we are having a blessing of the animal service before our dinner. So you can come to the parking lot with your pet if it's well-contained or well-trained. And we will do a lovely outdoor service as long as the weather is good. And then you can find a safe place for your pet. We Mark Overacker, we've done this last year. His fenced-in yard is available to well-behaved dogs and friends of Cooper. And then you can come in for a lovely meal with foods from the Middle East. So we have Lebanese chicken skewers with a garlic sauce, lentils and rice, couscous salad, tossed salad, and a Persian love cake for dessert. And there's a sample of that love cake out on Heritage Hall during our mingle and munch, along with some homemade cinnamon rolls from the Aagaard household. So I hope you will stay for some of that delicious food today and come back on Wednesday. We have lots of announcements today for you. I want to share one important opportunity that came up to help with response to Hurricane Helene and The Presbytery of the Peaks, which is our local organization of Presbyterian churches, is organizing a cleanup bucket drive, and this is rapid response. So I have a list here of what is in each bucket. You essentially could go to a Lowe's, and this might be a fun like search and find activity with a kid or a relative or a friend, and you find everything on this list and bring it back next Sunday. And we are going to spend time during Sunday school, hopefully. We are hoping to pack these buckets. And Rachel tells me it's a very fun game of Tetris, because she's done this before, and you take things out of their packaging, you tuck it in, and then it's everything you need to kind of clean out mud, to scrub your walls, to dry. There's a clothesline in there. There's a lot of good stuff all contained in 1 5-gallon bucket. So if you would like to participate, please find me at the cookies and lemonade table. I will have copies of this. If you would like to just give money towards these cleanup buckets, it's about $75 a bucket, and I will happily shop. And so we can do cash or check, or if you were to give online, we should make sure we designate it towards the cleanup buckets. So I talked with Janet Chisholm, who's in charge of the crop walk this year. She let me know that 2,360 buckets have already been sent to the Western North Carolina, that region. And so it also, you'll find another opportunity to give and to show support on October 20th with a crop walk. The crop walk is also under the umbrella of Church World Service, and the money raised during the crop walk, it responds to global hunger and poverty, but it also goes towards disaster relief, food, and water needs. And so I know that we will be seeing ways to respond over the next weeks and months, and I am excited to be in a position to respond with you all. So I hope that you will take the opportunities that come and that feel right for you. I am now going to turn it over to first Ellen Jones to give us an announcement about the grounds cleanup.
Good morning. This next week looks like a really great fall weather week, and I know that reminds everybody of pumpkin patches, football, and of course, yard work. On next Saturday, starting at 9 o'clock, we'll hold our annual fall grounds cleanup. We had a great turnout in the spring, and I hope we can repeat that. The goal of our fall work is simplification. We're trying to decrease some of the work needed to maintain our grounds. You may have noticed the bench and the flagstones outside of Heritage Hall in the circle. We're doing what we can to decrease our garden maintenance. We welcome all willing individuals to join us for some fellowship while gardening. Bring your tools and join us on Sunday morning. We'll fuel up with some coffee and Danish to get us going before we work. And I hope to see you there. Thank you.
Up next, we also have a special announcement from Ann Curran about the preschool fundraiser.
Good morning. You know, during this past week, I've seen God's love going out with God's hands and feet all over the South, North Carolina, Georgia, Florida. So I hope you'll all remember, you know, we're supposed to love our neighbors. So in that act of love, we're having a fundraiser again for the preschool. So God loves the children just as much as he loves everybody else. So we're having a silent auction, raffle baskets, spaghetti dinner, all sorts of fun on October the 19th. We'll take reservations for dinner out in Heritage Hall today and next Sunday. In your bulletin, you saw a little sheet for sponsorship. If you can't be there, don't want to be there, just like to give a monetary gift, we would love to have that as well. So if you're sending a check in, please note preschool fundraiser so it can be designated to the right area. So I hope to see you on the 19th, but if not, please, I hope you'll sponsor us in some shape, form, or fashion. Thank you.
We are invited to bring our whole selves to worship, our hopes and fears, our joys and concerns. Today we lift up the things we carry on our hearts here as a community together. Perhaps like me, you give thanks for the changing of the seasons, for the cool air that you can feel settling into the valley, and the changing of the leaves bringing a new spectrum of color for us to enjoy. We also hold the concerns that we share together. We especially pray today for Traylin's mother-in-law, Linda Fawcett, who had a heart attack last night and was shared in the book today. So please continue to be in prayer for Linda and that family. And I know you probably also carry some concerns that may or may not be listed, and we hold those as well. That is part of worshiping together as being a community of support and care for one another. And let us now prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Hallelujah.
among us and we are called to worship, let us stand together and sing.
Let us now approach God in prayer. The Lord draws near. Lord, hear our prayer. Forgive our sins, harsh words, unkind thoughts, broken promises. In this and every season, grow our faith, expand our generosity, deepen our joy. Strengthen our commitment to you. For you, O God, deliver us from evil. And by your steadfast love, we are forgiven. Amen.
Invite any children to come up, and you can sit right along the front here because we are going to watch something on our big screen TV today. All right, as you guys come up, I have one more thing I forgot to announce and mention. Some of you might notice the giant stacks of water bottles. Did you guys see those coming in? People have been bringing them in this past week to respond to the need down in Asheville, specifically at Montreat, which is a camp and conference center that many of us here have been to and gone to and worked at or enjoyed a week at. And we have a local connection, Sharon Nance, who is here at this church. Her son Jason works there. And he came up from Asheville after the hurricane and let everyone know that there was a need and that Montreat would be a kind of a hub for people to come to. So we responded by getting all that stuff. He did take down one load. He has a pickup truck. He took one load down on Saturday, and he will be coming back for the rest of it, but we can pause. We don't need to bring any more. We will be loading up what is out there, and we will be finding, you know, other new ways to respond as the weeks go on, like I said. So thank you to everyone who gave. And now I want to turn our attention to our screen. I put together this video with some inspiration from Pastor Kyle, because today we're kicking off the idea of a harvest of blessings. I started talking about this on Rally Day, if you remember, and we're going to keep talking about it now through October into November. And today we're thinking about how our church life has a season. Let's see. Let's press play. And there's a beautiful song that goes along with it. Oh, oopsies. I just stopped it. Choir, I'm sorry this isn't connected to your TV. I will have it out in Heritage Hall for anyone who wants to see it afterwards. This is our beautiful logo Reverend Rachel made for us. So we're thinking about how church is all season long, right? Every season of the year. Playing in the leaves. Our year, we celebrate every season, and we get to enjoy that with traditions every year, right? Things that come around every year. Worship and music, we have traditions, and faith formation, congregational care, missions, discipleship, fellowship. Every year we do new things and then old things as well that we get to enjoy. That was just this last Wednesday. Our youth lock-in over there. We do that every year. This one's coming up again. We're going to do Blessing of the Animals this Wednesday. Crop walk is coming up again. This was a habitat build last summer. Our retreat, a new tradition we get to start back up again. Vacation Bible school. This was Rally Day this year in our backyard. So I hope that's inspiring you to think about the things in your life that come in a season, right? That's one of the best parts of the year for me now that I'm a parent, is getting to share those seasonal things with my kids, right? I bet we all have those feelings of excitement when something new comes along, like Christmas, right? Every year, getting ready for Christmas, it was one of my favorite things. But also just remembering that everything comes in its time, and that we get to see the seeds getting planted and then them coming along, and we get to harvest a wonderful, wonderful harvest, right? Sorry, you can't see the kids making funny faces. All right, let us now share some love and some peace with our church family. Can you go out, stand up with me? Let's say our prayer together. and then we will go out to children's worship. Say, God, please help me feel your love and share your love with others. Amen. All right, the peace of Christ be with you. Thank you.
Seated. Please listen to our prayer for illumination. Let us pray. Holy God, in the wide spaces of our hearts, the deep recesses of our minds, and the furrows of our souls, speak to us your holy word. For you, O God, are Lord of every season, and we long to be firmly grounded in you. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. You can find this in your pew Bible on page 578 and 579 of the Old Testament. Seeking God's Spirit to grow our faith, let us listen to this reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
The truth is this. This too is gospel. God is the God of all seasons. That is the audacious claim made by Ecclesiastes that in the seasons of flood and drought, faith and doubt, youth and old age, laughing and crying, sowing and reaping, living and dying, war and peace, national and international elections, God is and remains the God of all seasons. While it is true that for everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, God is the center that holds forever. God is the generous giver of a harvest of blessings that never ceases. God is the one constant that never falters. God is the God of life before, in, and beyond human history, who always, always abounds in steadfast love and tender mercy, and who tirelessly, faithfully, and forgivingly works through all sorts of means to redeem, restore, and reunite our one world family. This is who God is, God of all seasons. A little later in chapter 3, Ecclesiastes says that it is this God who puts eternity into our minds and who calls us daily to glorify God's name, to trust God's promises and purposes, and to bring God joy by being humans who draw their life from God and give it back again. The same message is confirmed in the life, death, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, and it is likewise the center of the church's witness, grounded in God's Holy Spirit, which gives us the guidance and the courage to share with God's world and each other in the church what God has indeed so generously given each and every one of us. Embedded in the furrows of our faith, we believe God, our Creator, gives us indeed a wonderful world. God follows that by giving us God's child, His Son, the earth's Savior, God made flesh, full of grace and truth to dwell among us. And as if that weren't enough, God gives us God's Holy Spirit who guides us to be the church, as you saw displayed in the slideshow during our time with the children. The scriptures clearly teach us that these gifts of grace that go to the heart of God's generous being for us and with us are, and you know this, never earned or deserved. They're just generous gifts. This is surely God's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is also God sowing and our reaping a harvest of blessings, so that we as a church, as God's covenant people, might share the fruits of those blessings with all others, and that they might experience the depth of God's generous love for them. Ray Zubler just taught a whole Sunday school class about that. And to do that so that others might experience the generous love of God, it invites, do I dare say, compels each of us to give generously of our concerted time, our many spiritual gifts, and our dollars, yes, our dollars, to support the work of the church through the remainder of this calendar year, and as good stewards, plan for the next. This is what God, who gives us this harvest of blessings, invites. Yea, loves us so much that perhaps we're compelled to to give of our time and our talents and our treasure to the church for our salvation and the salvation of humankind. God is saying to us as a church family today, and I don't think it's only today, it's probably every day if we're listening closely enough. God says, the generosity I've shown you, you are to share with the world and each other in my name. You, my beloved church, whom I love to death and everlasting life, whom I place upon the earth to love me with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and whom I desire to be a grateful, giving, and generous people. You, my beloved church, God says, you, Covenant Presbyterian, have been blessed with a harvest of blessings to honor my name by making my lasting legacy of grace known to the world that I so dearly love. By loving your neighbors as yourselves, no exceptions, no questions, no waffling. By serving my justice, God says, and showing my kindness to all. By growing my kingdom on earth. And by promoting the common good and unity of my one world family. Put simply and plainly, the God of all seasons calls us to be the church of God for all seasons, for all people. But how do we accomplish that? Through worship and music, we gather, yes, we do, in person and online, praising God for God's goodness and receiving from God the bread of life and the cup of salvation, from which communion with God, in community with each other, gives us great strength for today and what we all need, bright hope for tomorrow. Through faith formation, we find ourselves reminded once again how important it is to study God's Word, to deepen our knowledge of God at work in our own lives, and indeed to pass the faith from one generation to the next. Through fellowship, we take bus trips, gather for Wednesday night dinners, welcome new members, roast marshmallows around campfires, bless dogs, revel in concerts on the church lawn, and realize this, that the ties which bind us to God and each other can never, no, never be broken. Through congregational care, we weep with those who weep. We rejoice with those who rejoice. We listen to each other's stories, celebrate each other's milestones, agree to disagree, and still love each other. And in the end, confess our hope and peace, our love and joy reside alone in Jesus Christ our Lord, the Son of the living God, for truly that is what unites us all together. One hope, one faith, one Lord. This is who we are as a congregation, serving the giving God of all seasons, a generous church for all seasons. Giving, did I say giving? In various forms, that word has surfaced throughout today's homily, stressing God's giving, our giving. And did I say generosity today? And maybe word forms of that as well. God's generosity, our generosity, both God's and our generous giving are always in season here at Covenant because the need is always there. But we can always do more. How can I be so certain of that? Let me tell you a story. There's a Presbyterian pastor named Carl Travis. He recently wrote a book entitled God's Gift of Generosity. Do you know what? He wrote it on his deathbed. He didn't think he was going to finish it before he died, but he did, and it was published in 2022. Carl Travis. He wrote it because he wanted to plant in our minds as a church family that giving begins with God. Now, before you dismiss this important point as a trivial one, in fact, maybe even a no-brainer, listen to what he has to say about God's giving and ours. He says, the biblical story of God's giving one gift after another is a tale of relentless, dynamic generosity. The Christian story is the saga of a loving Creator so compelled by love, so possessed of grace, so hungry for relationship that there's no end to God's willingness to give and God's capacity to give. Think about it. Until, Carl Travis says, until, that is, God gives God's very self, God's own child, Jesus Christ. Then, to sharpen our focus more squarely on God's limitless generosity, Reverend Travis turns to John 3:16. Without minimizing its glorious good news of everlasting life in Christ, and that's the part we remember, that's the one we repeat, that's the one you see, John 3:16, between the goalposts at football games. He makes the compelling case that what is so often overlooked in John 3:16 concerning God's generosity is that God, and I have this word capitalized, is that God gave. God so loved the world that God gave. What is so striking, so moving, so transformational here is the link between generosity and love. Think about it. God so loved the world that God gave. The cliche has it that love is less a noun than a verb, less a thing than an action. Love expressed, love unexpressed, unrevealed, untended is something less than love. Love unexpressed, unrevealed, untended is something less than love. Generosity then is what love does. Love gives. Love does not take. Love articulates itself in giving. Beloved, in my 7+ years serving as your pastor, I know you love God. I know you love each other. I know you love covenant. I know that as sure as I stand here today. Through all our ups and downs, ins and outs, joys and celebrations, you have shown a deep commitment to the triune God of heaven and earth by remaining committed to covenant's mission, by showing your resiliency during the lean years of COVID and other seasons of the church's life together, and by fulfilling a genuine desire to help others in this faith family and beyond experience the love of God mightily at work in you. Now is the opportunity for you to determine what you will give in the year to come to support a new pastor in her work and to unite as one to address the needs of a growing mission-minded church planted here in the valley, with branches rooted in Christ extending literally across the globe. If you truly love the Lord, and I know you do, what will you generously give to God to expand covenant's reach even further out for God's namesake? Maybe you can talk about that with God when we gather at the welcome table here in a bit, and experience yet again God's overwhelming grace and never-ending generosity. Or perhaps on the way home with a loved one, you can talk about it and see where that leads you. Yes, for everything there's a season and a time for every matter under heaven. Covenant, this is your time to dig deep, to dig deeper, and really do something outrageously generous with your time, your spiritual gifts, and yes, oh yes, your dollars. With that seed planted, I will leave it to you and to God to watch it grow. Amen.
Oh,
this day we celebrate World Communion Sunday. People of faith from all over the world gather at Christ's table. In languages as diverse as God's people, and at tables of every size and shape, we proclaim together the unity of the body of Christ. This table belongs to Christ and extends to every corner of the earth.
This is the table to which Jesus invites us. Here seeds of faith are planted and nourished. Here mercy is shared and love is poured out. Here the harvest is abundant and grace is sown in our lives. Come, for this is a table where all are invited and the welcome is wide.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we praise you that you designed the universe good. With your hands you gave form to chaos, forming us in your image, filling us with your breath of life. Your power broke bonds of oppression. Your love initiated covenant and community. Your mercy welcomes outcasts home. We praise you for your faithfulness from generation to generation.
Oh God, when our love for you and one another falls short, and when our world is broken apart by mistrust and fear, you love us still. You have led us through the wilderness, given us your law to guide us, and spoke through the prophets to call us back to you.
In this fullness of time, out of your great love for the world, you sent your only Son to be one of us, to redeem us and heal our brokenness. Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, opened blind eyes, broke bread with outcasts and sinners, and proclaimed the good news of your kingdom to all. Dying on the cross, he saves us. Risen from the dead, he gives new life. Living with you, he prays for us.
Merciful Lord, we praise you for good gifts of bread and wine, and for the table you spread in the world as a sign of your love for all people in Christ. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, so that they may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ.
May we be one with all who share this feast on this day of all days, with all your children at every corner of your table. Unite us in hope, vision, purpose, and ministry in every time and in every place. As we share in Christ's love over bread and cup, O God, we remember all those who suffer around the world. Held in God's love, may we embrace those who are in pain. Freed by God's mercy, may we forgive those who have hurt us. Bound by God's new covenant, may we strengthen our own relationships with one another. We pray these things until the joyous day of resurrection, when we will all feast with you at your table in glory. Through Christ, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, with the Holy Spirit. Now and forever. Amen. And so we give thanks that on the night of his arrest, the Lord took bread, and after giving thanks for it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, Jesus took the cup. And he said unto his disciples, whom he so dearly loved, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Drink you all of it in remembrance of me." Truly, beloved, these are the gifts of God. Prepare for the people of God. Come, all is now ready.
Thank you. Would you pray with me? God of all nations, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a glimpse of your eternal kingdom. We offer our thanks for the corner that reaches to every, for the table that reaches to every corner of the earth, and for the ministry of churches around the world who gather with us today. In a world stretching toward wholeness, we celebrate with those whose lives bear the fruit of your Spirit, and we seek to share in your call to partnership. We celebrate with those whose efforts are making the world new. We celebrate with all who gather to earnestly seek your transforming work in the world.
Holy God, as we pray for your church, we pray for all who are hungry, whether hungry for power and glory or hungry for a simple meal. Show the mighty that you alone can satisfy their deepest need and feed the poor from the abundance of your good creation.
God of compassion, hear our prayers for all in need, for the sick, the poor, and the dying, for those who feel as if they are strangers in our land, and for those who are invisible or silenced. In your mercy, help us remember and care for ones who sleep without shelter, all who hunger or who are lost. Stir up in us the capacity to see ourselves in one another's struggles and to act so that others may have life abundantly. Guide and strengthen us all to know the gifts of your grace and love. As you have nourished us in Christ Jesus, send us forth to feed and serve others. Make us a world that grows into the shape of your communion table, where all are welcomed and all are fed. Make us a people who grow your family by practices of empathy, generosity, and justice, sowing seeds of peace in every action we take. May the church yearn to proclaim the good news of a world made new and a mercy wider than imaginations can span. We pray these things boldly using the words you taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today and every day we see signs of God's grace and abundance, but we also know that there is suffering and need in the world. We give freely of what we have been given as a witness to God's action in the world. We offer now gifts that God has so generously shared with us. Let us share our tithes and offerings in joy and in gratitude for all that God has given us.
Thank you. will join us on the second verse, if you know it, because I don't have the words written here. But listen, and hopefully you can join us in for a second time through.